Okay, let's begin. 10:01. We learned the Mishnah. We had the eight arguments between Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel. We learned the Gemara that began with a Tosefta, a Braisa. Let me mute everyone here. It started with this Braisa that spoke about do you recite Kiddush before Yayin, or do you recite the Yayin before the Kiddush? And what that means is, do you it's based on the first case in our Mishnah. Our Mishnah started with what's the first argument in our Mishnah between Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel. It's how to say Kiddush Friday night or the night of Yom Tov. Do you first say the bracha on the wine and then the Mekadesh HaShabbos or Mekadesh Yisrael V'Yazmanim? Or do you first say the Mekadesh HaShabbos or Mekadesh Yisrael V'Yazmanim and afterwards you say the bracha on the wine? And so this was a machlokes Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel. And the braisa that the Gemara brings gives a little explanation, gives some reason behind it. And the reason that it gives two reasons for each of the rabbis. The first one is Beis Shammai says, first recite the bracha about the holiness of the day, the sanctity of the day, and afterwards the bracha on the wine. And he says the reason is because the day causes the wine to come, which means seemingly that the only reason you're drinking wine is because of Shabbos. So first sanctify the Shabbos and then drink the wine for the Kiddush. But the day is what's causing it to come, is what's causing the wine. And therefore, the sanctity of the day is more important. The second point that Beis Shammai makes is that what comes first in the order of, in the schedule, first comes the Shabbos and then comes the Kiddush, then comes the wine. So when you're sanctifying the day with reciting the bracha on the day came before the recital of the day came before the drinking of the wine. And therefore, in Kiddush, when you're reciting the brachas, first do the first one first. First do the sanctification of the day, and then do the sanctification of the wine. Now, we did mention a complicated slach yesterday about would these reasons apply if you make Kiddush early on Friday? And would it apply if you make Kiddush on challah instead of on wine? And I mentioned yesterday that it's a very hard slach because really the simple understanding would be that, yes, the reasons apply to all those cases because the day, the holiness, you would think, comes when you accept Shabbos, even if you accept Shabbos early. In fact, Rashi says, "Ukvar kiddush hayoyim." Look at Rashi. Rashi says on eight lines up, maybe 10 lines up from the bottom of the page, "Ukvar kiddush hayoyim." Rashi gives two options. What are the two options of kiddush hayoyim? One of them is misha kibla yolov. Once you accept Shabbos on yourself, then the day becomes sanctified. And the second thing is, or from the time of tzei sakir chavim, from the time when the stars come out. So you have two options. In either option, the holiness of the day arrives by the earliest one, either when you accepted Shabbos or when the stars come out. So Rashi seems to be telling us clearly that even if you accept Shabbos early, before it's like a person is supposed to, you're supposed to accept Shabbos early, called the Tosefta Shabbos. So even if you accept Shabbos early, the holiness of the day starts when you accept it. And that would mean that Beis Shammai's reason of what comes first, goes first in brachas, would be that even if you accept Shabbos early, the bracha you should recite first is the holiness of the day, because you accepted Shabbos early, the holiness of the day came first. And then afterwards, you're going to drink the wine. So that was one point that we couldn't understand really so clearly with why the Tzlach wants to learn differently. Unless there's another source that argues with Rashi, and he wants to follow another commentary, and that would be based on understanding acceptance of Shabbos early differently than we understand it. And the way to understand that would be that when you're accepting Shabbos early, are you just accepting not to do any work? Or is it there is some type of a sanctification that has arrived for you? Is Shabbos sanctified already by you, that Shabbos has arrived? Or you're just saying, no, I'm not doing work now, but it's not that Shabbos has not arrived for me. I'm just separating myself from work. So that's the way it seems that the Tzlach is learning, that you maybe are, when you accept Shabbos early, the sanctification of Shabbos hasn't arrived. You've just limited yourself from working. And if you learn it that way, then you could say the way he wants to explain that these reasons have limitations, and that's why Beis Shammai needs two reasons, because each of the reasons has its limits. And the way he would learn would be that this reasoning of Beis Shammai would not apply if you accepted Shabbos early. So that's one point. And the other point is something that David had touched upon, and that is that when you make Kiddush on Challah, so can you say that the day is what causes the challah? So I mentioned the simple understanding is not like the Tzlach, and that is that reasoning would apply even if you make Kiddush on challah. Because if you make Kiddush on challah, what causes you to eat challah on Shabbos? It's the holiness of the day of Shabbos is what's getting you to eat the challah. So what is the more integral element of this Kiddush? The most important part of it is the sanctification of the day, which is the Kiddush bracha, Mekadesh Shabbos. And that's what's causing you to eat challah. If not for the sanctification of the day, you wouldn't be running to eat challah. Now, you make Kiddush on wine, you make Kiddush on challah, whatever it is, the holiness of the day is telling you, you know what, you have to sanctify it with something, with challah. So it's the day that's causing you to have wine or to have challah. Now, the Tzlach didn't want to learn that way. He says the day is causing you to have wine. Challah you have to have anyway because it's a holiday. And the question we had is, well, of course, it's the holiday. That's exactly it. If it's a holiday, that's what's causing you to have the challah also. So the holiday is what's causing it. So say the bracha on the holiday. The holiday is what's causing it. And the Tzlach didn't seem to want to learn that way. He wanted to learn that it's the Kiddush obligates the wine, but it doesn't obligate the challah because the holiday obligates the challah. So what I realized, I looked up the Gemara in Sukkah, and Rashi over there in Sukkah says it a little differently. So the way our Gemara and our Rashi learns, I don't think the Tzlach's shot would fit, but the way the Rashi and Sukkah learns, that's maybe where the Tzlach is coming up with his understanding. And the Rashi over there in Sukkah says that the day causes the wine. He says, if not for the Kiddush, you would not be having a cup of wine before the meal. The Kiddush is what obligates the wine. So when he says this, the yoim causes, the day causes the wine, it doesn't, he's learning that it doesn't mean the day, the holiness of Shabbos. He's learning it means the wording of Kiddush, it's the Kiddush that obligates the wine. And if you learn it that way, then you could say, well, the Kiddush, the prayer of Kiddush is not what obligates the challah. The challah is obligated for the holiday. It's a Shabbos. Shabbos, you have to have challah anyway. Whether you have it in the Kiddush or afterwards, you need it anyway. The wine, you don't need necessarily. But the challah In other words, the kiddush obligates you to have, in order to say the kiddush, you need to have the kiddush obligates you to have a couple wine. But the kiddush doesn't obligate the challah. The challah would be an obligation automatically from the holiness of Shabbos. And because of that, he says that reason wouldn't apply. So in other words, the tzlach must be basing it on the Rashi and Sukkah. And that's a little what David had asked yesterday. David was wondering, what does it mean the day is obligating the wine? And it seems that there's two ways of learning. Is it the day meaning the saint, the holiness of the day? Or is it the day meaning the kiddush, the recital of the kiddush that is obligating the wine, the recital of the kiddush, which sanctifies the day. In other words, the wording is the sanctification of the day, but it means the recital of kiddush that sanctifies the day is what's obligating you to have wine, and therefore the sanctification would go first. So again, this is where we're discussing the wording of kiddush based on Beis Shammai, who we don't go like, but we're trying to understand why he says two reasons, and the tzlach was trying to answer that. Okay, so that leaves that point gives us a little understanding of that that insight. Now the Gemara mentioned this Braisa, and it told us Beis Hillel's reason as well. What was Beis Hillel's reason? Beis Hillel had a reason that the wine causes the Kedusha to be recited. In other words, you already said Kiddush and Davin. So now, the fact that you're reciting Kiddush on wine is, why are you saying Kiddush again? Only because of the wine. Because the actual Kiddush you already said already. You said Mekadesh HaShabbos in the Shemoneh Esrei, in your prayer. So why are you saying Kiddush now at night? It's because of the wine. So the wine is causing you to say Kiddush. And if you wouldn't have wine, you don't say this Kiddush. And the same thing would be the challah would be the same thing. That if you're having the challah is what's causing you to say the Kiddush. Now, that would be the first reason. Now, the second reason that's mentioned by Beis Hillel is we have the famous rule of tadir v'she'inoi tadir kodem, something that's more often done and one something that's less often done. You always do the thing that's more often done. And what is the thing that's more often done? The thing that's more often done is the bracha on the wine, because you have it at weddings, you have the wine at benchings, you have the wine for kiddushes, you have the wine in more events than you have the sanctification. You have the wine at Havdalahs. Yeah, you have it more than kiddush, and therefore this would be the more usual thing. And we find this law based. This law Rashi brings that it's based on the carbon tamid, that there is a carbon called tamid, like similar to tadir, and the carbon tamid is the carbon that we brought twice a day, the sheep in the morning and the sheep in the afternoon, and that carbon was the daily sacrifice. It was the one that started the sacrifice, the one that ended all the sacrifices of the day. And that carbon was always brought first before the carbon musaf. So it says milvad, milvad oilas habayker asher lo oilas atamid tazu asel. You do the musaf after you do the carbon tamid. So the Gemara understands that the tamid is always first, and that applies to all things that are called, that are tamid or that are tadir. They always should come first. Something that's more usual comes first. Now, the commentaries do ask a question on this Gemara. And the commentaries ask, which one is biblical and which one is rabbinic? The bracha on the Kiddush, the Mekadesh HaShabbos, is Zachreyu, it's a bracha. The bracha on the Kiddush would seemingly be a bracha, a biblical bracha. You're supposed to be Mekadesh. You're supposed to sanctify the Shabbos. The bracha on the wine is a rabbinic institution that you have to have wine for kiddush. So why does Beis Hillel say that you should go the bracha that's more usual, the Borei Pri HaGafen bracha, which is more often recited, over the bracha that's less often recited, Mekadesh HaShabbos? Why doesn't Beis Hillel take into consideration the fact that Mekadesh HaShabbos is biblically obligated and the bracha on the wine is only rabbinically obligated, right? That would seemingly be much more important. This is a biblical obligation and that's a rabbinic obligation. So why doesn't he take that into consideration? So this boils down to an old question that we've mentioned once or twice. It's come up that Kiddush, the mitzvah in the Torah to recite Kiddush is not on wine. The mitzvah in the Torah is you have to remember the Shabbos, and the way to remember it is by reciting the bracha Mekadesh HaShabbos, Zachrehu. It's a mitzvah to remember it with special clothing and with words. And the words are, remember it, and it's b'yichnisasai, b'yitziyasai, when it comes in, when it goes out. So you honor the Shabbos by reciting the prayer sanctifying that Hashem sanctifies the Shabbos. So that's the bracha of Kiddush. The wine part is the rabbi said, Zachreyu ala yayin. The rabbi said, you know what? You make Kiddush, you have to do it with wine. So the wine part is rabbinic. The bracha on Kiddush is biblical. But the thing is that you already did say the bracha of Kiddush in the davening. So when you davened, did you already fulfill the obligation of Kiddush? And if you did fulfill the obligation of Kiddush on a biblical level, then we have no problem here with our Gemara, because that would mean that the Kiddush on the wine, both brachas are rabbinic. But if you did not fulfill your biblical obligation with the Kiddush in the davening, then we would say that the bracha later on the Kiddush, the bracha of wine is rabbinic, the bracha of the Kiddush would be biblical. And that would be a question on our Gemara. Now, another offshoot of this question is, can you fulfill the obligation of Kiddush for your wife if you already fulfilled your obligation of Kiddush in Shul, the biblical obligation? Now you would only be a rabbinic. You would only be obligated rabbinically in Kiddush because you already fulfilled your obligation of Kiddush in Shul on a biblical level. And your wife didn't daven Ma'ariv, so she has an obligation on a biblical level and you only have an obligation on a rabbinic level. And there are sources that would say that you can't fulfill her obligation if you're only obligated on a rabbinic level. You can't fulfill someone who's obligated on a biblical level. There are such sources. It's not necessarily according to everyone, but there could be an issue there. So how can you make Kiddush for your wife? You hear the question? How can you make Kiddush for your wife if you fulfilled your biblical obligation in Shul and then you come home and you say, listen, I was yaitz already, my kiddush. I'll make it on the wine. Okay, rabbinic obligation now I'm doing. Oh, your wife, she didn't daven yet. She didn't daven my room. How is she? How are you going to fulfill the obligation at home for her? You're only obligated rabbinically. She's obligated biblically. So on this, one of the commentaries says, you know how she fulfills her obligation? As long as she says good Shabbos, she's fulfilled her biblical obligation just like you fulfilled it in Shul by saying Mekadesh HaShabbos. She's fulfilled it when she accepts Shabbos, the candle lighting, or saying good Shabbos or something like that. So it could be that she's also fulfilled her biblical obligation. That's brought down as one of the options. Anyway, this question boils down to over our Gemara because it does connect with the our Gemara of which one comes first. Should we take that into consideration? One of them is biblical, one of them is rabbinic. So one of the commentaries, the Shai Desaryeh, wants to say, you see from here, that when a mitzvah is rabbinic, it takes precedence over a biblical mitzvah if it's more often. Even if it's only rabbinic, it takes precedence over a biblical. This is quite a insight that it takes precedence if it's more often, even though it's rabbinic, it'll take precedence. You see that from our Gemara that Beis Hillel says. You say the bracha on the wine before the Kiddush bracha, even though the Kiddush bracha maybe could be biblical. So again, there's different ways of learning. Is the Kiddush bracha biblical or is it rabbinic based on these two ways? Now, the reason you might want to say it's biblical is because there is a minchas chinuch that says that when the rabbis said you have to make Kiddush on wine, they are now taking the biblical obligation of Kiddush and saying that you should not be fulfilling it until you do it with the wine. In other words, they're removing the biblical obligation that you could fulfill with just saying the words and saying, no, it has to be done with the wine. And now that becomes the biblical obligation. In other words, you're not fulfilling your biblical obligation unless you do it the way the rabbis explained how to do it, which would be with the wine. And that's how you fulfill your biblical obligation. And according to that, you have this Shagas Aryeh, the way he's explained that it comes out that you need to fulfill a mitzvah that's more often first, even if it's a rabbinic mitzvah versus a biblical mitzvah. Okay, so that just touches on some of the discussions based on our Gemara, which have application in our, the way we fulfill the mitzvah on Shabbos, on every Shabbos. This is a good question. Are you fulfilling your biblical obligation with Kiddush at home, or are you fulfilling your rabbinic? Can you fulfill the mitzvah for your wife or for someone else who didn't hear it at all and didn't daven? Yes, Ben, you're muted, Ben. Ben, you're muted.
Sorry. I wondered if you have a glass of wine during the week or if you sit down for family dinner during the week with wine. Do you do the you have to say the blessing on wine?
Yeah, for sure.
Very anytime.
Yeah.
That's why it's so often, not just because weddings.
No. Good point. Good question. But the thing is that we do not take into consideration something that is optional. Optional
Brachas. Is optional. You mean the wine is optional?
The wine is optional.
Yeah.
When it's optional, that's not called it's done more often.
Okay.
Only when it's obligated do we consider it more often. So that's a good question, but that's the commentaries don't explain it that way, that it's based on the fact that you could do it often because that's only optional.
Okay.
So that doesn't fall into the rule of Tadir. Okay, so we are now, so now we have the next discussion, and that is that as the Gemara had, as we turned the page to 52a, we were discussing this end of the Braisa says the halacha follows Beis Hillel. And I mentioned to you that there's another Gemara. We mentioned the Gemara yesterday that tells us an interesting thing, that why is the halacha like Beis Hillel? And it says Beis Hillel would put the Beis Shammai before they would say their opinion. They would mention Beis Shammai and so on. And we saw that they were very humble and had great traits. And therefore, the halacha follows them. Now, this is one part of the equation. There is another part of the equation that also has to be taken into consideration, and that is that Beis Shammai was actually smarter than Beis Hillel. So you have Beis Shammai who's smarter, you have Beis Hillel who's more humble, and then you also have that Beis Hillel is more numerous. So you have the numbers, you have the humility, and you have Beis Shammai, who's more smart. And heavenly voice called out that you got to follow Beis Hillel. You follow Beis Hillel. And it's really based on two other Gemaras, these considerations. There's a Gemara, which we saw yesterday in Erevin. There's also a Gemara in Yevamos. And both of these Gemara, they mention these ideas that Beis Shammai was more smarter, Beis Hillel was more humble, Beis Hillel had more, was more numerous, and so on. And so you have these issues that are coming up, and there's a baskoil, this heavenly voice that says we've got to follow Beis Hillel. Now, our Gemara is asking a question. It says, what do you need a heavenly voice to call out that the halacha follows Beis Hillel? What do you need a brisa to tell you that the halacha follows Beis Hillel? We always follow Beis Hillel, right? So that's what our Gemara had asked. It said, pshita, we always follow Beis Hillel. There's a heavenly voice. Why would we always follow Beis Hillel? A heavenly voice called out that you follow Beis Hillel. So the brisa needs to tell me that the halacha follows Beis Hillel. We always follow Beis Hillel. That's the heavenly voice, a baskoil. So the Gemara has two answers. One of them is that before the heavenly voice called out that the halacha follows Beis Hillel, it says it took 3 years till this heavenly voice called out that the halacha follows Beis Hillel. So during that time, this brisa was learned. And the brisa was learned that this is the halacha. So it was before the heavenly voice. The second explanation is, could be we don't follow the heavenly voice. The two answers that we have are all connected to this heavenly voice. Do we follow a baskoil or don't we? So first way is you follow the baskoil, the heavenly voice. Second way is no, we follow Rabbi Yeshua, the brisa follows Rabbi Yeshua that you don't follow a baskoil. Now, this is very interesting. The Gemara earlier in Brochos, based on a Gemara in Baba Metzia, talks about this Tanur Shel Achnai. It was a oven that had layers of earthenware that were sliced in pieces, and they put sand in the middle, and there was a question if it could be susceptible to Tumah, to impurity or not. And it was an argument between Rabbi Eliezer and the Chachamim. Rabbi Eliezer held that it's tahar, the rabbi said it's tameh, and the Rabbi Eliezer tried to prove his point with making miracles and saying, if I am correct, let the walls of the base medrash shake, the walls caved in. If I am correct, if I am correct, let there be a heavenly voice. And all of a sudden, a heavenly voice said, the halacha is always like Rabbi Eliezer. A heavenly voice came out and screamed that and Rabbi Yeshua stands up and says, this doesn't mean anything. We are the ones who make the halacha. It depends on this world. Whatever heavens can do anything, angels, God himself can say, this is where the halacha is, down here on earth. And ein mashgichin bebaskol. So the Gemara seems very clear over there that we have to follow Rabbi Yeshua and the rabbis, and we don't follow Rabbi Eliezer. In fact, they even put Rabbi Eliezer in Cherem because he wasn't accepting the ruling of the rabbis. So they excommunicated him, so to speak. Anyway, so the law is that we don't follow a baskar. So the question is that if we don't follow a baskoil, why do we hold like Beis Hillel all the time? What's this? We seem to always think that we follow Beis Hillel, and that's the halacha. But are we really supposed to follow Beis Hillel? The only reason we're following him is because of a heavenly voice. And we know that the heavenly voice means zero, right? The baskoil is ein mashgichin bebaskoil. You don't look at a baskoil. You don't supervise. You don't rely on a baskoil. So that's it. We shouldn't follow a baskoil, but why is the halacha like Beis Hillel? Yes, Ben.
I wanted to say, Beit Shammai, I think, was harder on the halacha or on the whatever the
Gvura
was.
It was Hira more
was Mikael.
Right.
But saying that Beit Shammai was smarter and Hillel had more students is a different story.
But the Gemara says that. I'm not saying that. I know. They were sharper.
Okay. Maybe they were deeper, you know.
Deeper.
The studying. If you have less students, you study a little deeper. If you have more students, you don't have the time to study as deep. So, but saying that, it seems that you're saying that Beit Hillel wasn't smart.
I liked your point. That's interesting. Yeah. That if you want to get a lot of students, if you go fast, you don't go so deep,
right,
and everyone enjoys it. You make it more, but if you go deep into things, if you go deep, people like to cover ground. That's an interesting point. Maybe that's why Daf Yomi is very popular, because they cover so much ground. Everyone's like, oh, I'm finishing. I don't know if they know it so well, but they're finishing. That's an interesting point. That it's easier to get a crowd if you're not going deeper. That's an interesting point. Anyway, bottom line, that you what did you want? What was your bottom line, Ben? That
was my bottom line, that Beit Hillel was probably just as smart as Beit Shammai. It's just that, you know, he had more time.
You mean in brains they were as smart, but he didn't go deep.
Beit Hillel, you know, that they're not smart, you know.
So you want to say they're just as smart, they just didn't go as deep.
All the Jews are smart.
Right. Okay, that's an interesting way of translating, of explaining it, that they're both equally as smart. There is a concept in Torah that it says machkimas pesi, pekudei Hashem yusharim misam chilev misam bermes. That it says machkimas pesi, that it says that the Torah has the ability to make wise even someone who's not smart. So yes, along the lines of that, smartens people up. The Torah is machkimas pesi. So, so your point is well taken. That it would seem that how could you say Beis Shammai is smarter than Beis Hillel? But I mean, there could be different levels of smartness. You know, they're definitely
They had more time per student to study. You know.
But in any event, if they went deeper, that would be a reason to follow the halacha should follow Beis Shammai. Logically, it would make sense to follow them if they went deeper into it. They know the topic, they know the subject inside out.
They're
machmir, but they know it. They know it inside out. It's better than someone who knows surface level or middle. It goes to the middle, but doesn't go to the depth. Doesn't finish. Doesn't go fully into the depth. So logically, Beis Shammai did have reason that we should follow them. So Tysmus over here and in other places deals with this problem that do we follow a Baskol or don't we? And the simple understanding is very interesting, that Beis Hillel has the majority vote. On the other hand, Beis Shammai was sharp. So the Baskol here is not going against what we know as halacha. We know as halacha, you generally follow the majority. Here, we question that majority. Maybe we shouldn't, because Beis Shammai was so deep. I don't know if we could follow the majority that we normally follow. We normally follow majority. That's the halacha. Under normal circumstances, you follow majority. Acharei rabim lahatois, right? You follow the majority. It's a pasuk in the Torah that you follow the majority, and we should follow Beis Hillel under all circumstances. The only thing is, we started questioning, well, you know, Beis Shammai was so mechadidi, they were so sharp, maybe we can't follow the majority in this scenario. So what did the Baskol do? It calls out and says, no, you follow Beis Hillel, even though Beis Shammai is so sharp, you still follow Beis Hillel and you follow the majority. So what did the Baskol do? It didn't tell us something really new. It just told us, yes, you rely on Beis Hillel on the majority. So it sort of confirmed what we knew already. It confirmed what we normally would follow. The other Baskol is a Baskol that's going against Halacha. The other Baskol wanted us to follow Rebbe Eliezer. And it said, the Halacha is like Rebbe Eliezer, b'chol makom, every place we follow Rebbe Eliezer. He is the, there's no one like him. Now that goes against Torah, because the rule follows the majority. So when the Baskol goes against the majority, we don't follow it. Ein mashgichin b'baskol. But when the majority is only just helping us it's only confirming that we even in this case we follow the majority, then we do use the Baskol to tell us to clarify that this is the accepted, this is the way that we can follow Beis Hillel. So that's a simple understanding of answering this question about following a heavenly voice. Now, what's interesting is that different Taisus, and they debate, what does Rabbi Yeshua himself hold? Does Rabbi Yeshua himself, does he hold that we never follow a Baskol, even in this scenario? Or does Rabbi Yeshua himself hold, by the case of Rabbi Eliezer, we don't follow the Baskol, but in case of Beis Hillel, we would follow a Baskol? What is Rabbi Yeshua himself hold? That's a debate amongst the Tosfos, the one here, the one in Yevamos. So it seems to be debated among Tosfos. But our Gemara says that there seems to be two ways of learning. In other words, let's think about what the Gemara said. The Gemara said that, why does the Braisa say halacha to Beis Hillel? We have a Baskol. So the first answer of the Gemara is that this was before the Baskol. What does that mean? Do we follow the Baskol? The Gemara answers, you know why it has to say halacha is like Beis Hillel? Because it was before we heard the Baskol. It was before it happened. If we heard the Baskol, we wouldn't even say the halachas like Beis Hillel, because it would be obvious the halachas like Beis Hillel. So do we follow a Baskol according to the first answer of the Gemara? Yes, we follow a Baskol, but we didn't hear it yet. So we had to say halacha to Beis Hillel. The rabbis had to say the halacha follows Beis Hillel because we didn't hear the Baskol yet. But if we heard the Baskol, then it would, of course, we would follow it. We would follow the heavenly voice. What is the second answer of the Gemara? The Bayesema, if you want, say that it's after the Baskol. We heard a Baskol already. And we still have to say the halacha follows Beis Hillel because we don't follow a Baskol. In Mashkichin b'Baskol, we don't follow a Baskol. It goes like Rabbi Yeshua. What does that mean? That even in this scenario, we're going to follow the majority, the Baskol has no say. Even when it says to follow the majority, it has no say. So what comes out from here is that our Gemara itself is telling us that there's two ways of learning. One way of learning is that certain cases you don't follow a Baskol, but certain cases you do follow a Baskol. That's one way of learning. And the other way of learning is you never follow a Baskol. According to Rabbi Yeshua, the way it fits with Rabbi Yeshua, you never follow a Baskol. Even if it helps, even if it's just to confirm that you follow majority, we do not follow Baskol ever. So these are the two ways in our Gemara itself how the Gemara seems to be learning. And it's a little unclear if the Gemara is saying that we don't follow a Baskol, even in our case, and we're following Rabbi Yeshua, even though Rabbi Yeshua might himself agree that here you follow a Baskol, we go stronger. This Braisa goes stronger than Rabbi Yeshua and says, even in a scenario where the Baskol is helping out the majority, is just telling you follow majority, even in this case, the Braisa says, don't follow a Baskol. Rabbi Yeshua himself might say, you do follow the Baskol. But this Braisa follows that logic of Rabbi Yeshua and says, even in this case, you never follow a Baskol. So our Gemara itself shows that there's two ways of understanding the rule of when do we follow a Baskol, when don't we. And what it seems like is, the question, if you want to boil it down to, so what is the real debate here? The heavens cannot tell us a halacha. Heaven, that's not, that's given to the rabbis. But the heavens maybe could tell us, could clarify us with us what the code is to figure out the halacha. What are the rules? We need to know the code. We need to know the policy. What is the policy? And then we will decide what the halacha is. But we need to know the policy. Can you, and so according to the first way of learning, that the heavens can tell us the policy is that in this scenario that we follow Beis Hillel, because the policy is that even though Beis Shammai might be Bechad Gitveh, you follow Beis Hillel. So maybe, I'm just throwing a thought that maybe it's telling us policy versus halacha. And that's why there could be a debate. The question on this is that it could be that it's not really telling us full-fledged policy, because it's only telling us policy in a certain scenario where you have Beis Hillel who's humble and Beis Shammai who's machadidi and Beis Hillel is majority. So you have, it's not just tips, it's not simple policy rules. In other words, simple policy rules would be, what do you do when you have majority on one side and you have chidud, sharpness on the other side? That would be, policy would say, okay, we follow majority or not? Okay, policy is you follow majority. Here, it's more, it's additional point that has to be added to the equation. You have also Beis Hillel, who is humble. So you have Beis Hillel, who's majority and humble, Beis Shammai, who's sharper. And on this, we need to know the policy. Yes, David.
Yeah, I don't know the details, but there's a sefer that I heard of called Shilas and Shubas Min HaShemayim.
Yeah.
So what's the deal with that?
Ah, that is a very good question you're asking. David is there was a great rabbi who wrote a sefer based on questions he had, and he would dream. In the dream, he would have answers that he would then write down in his sefer. And David is asking, that sounds like you're not allowed to follow that, because that's just based on a dream. And based on a dream, Torah is not from heavens. You had prophecy. You shouldn't be following that. Does anyone want to answer this question? I think Isaac has an answer. No? Anyone?
I have no answer at all. The guy dreams and he wants to follow Gesunte Hay, but don't tell me what to do.
No, this is a very famous sefer. The response
I know.
Anyone?
The Ramchal also used to have directly from the Malach.
Yes, Ben, you have an answer?
Well, I thought that after the Nevuah stopped, we don't believe in people's telling us about their dreams.
Well, that's another story, that why should we even believe in the prophecy or anything? But the question is that
prophecy was okay, but prophecy stopped.
Right, prophecy stopped. But the question is more that we don't follow. The Torah is not based on heaven, it's based on earth.
Yeah.
So it would seem that, it would seem that I'm just going to throw a thought that when he woke up in the morning, he evaluated each of those answers and came to the conclusion based on human mind that they are correct. In other words, he didn't just rely on what his soul understood from heaven, but he used his brain afterwards to make sure he was comfortable with it from a human perspective. And that would be a reason why he would be able to write these responsa and rely on it halachically, is because he utilized his human brain to be able to absorb, if that's the, that each of these halachas makes sense. That's just a thought. I don't know. I'm gonna have to look into it more, but that's what comes to my mind. Okay, so it's a good question. Very good question, Dora. Okay, so the Gemara continues over here, and the Gemara has a problem, has a question, has a contradiction. What does Beis Shammai hold about Kiddush? Which bracha do you make first? Wine or Mekadesh HaShabbos? Which one? What does Beis Shammai hold?
Mekadesh HaShabbos.
Mekadesh HaShabbos comes first. Different than what we do. Beis Shammai says you do Mekadesh HaShabbos. What does Beis Shammai hold about Havdalah?
Nail.
So when it comes to Havdalah, the Gemara asks a question and says that we have a brisa that talks about reciting Havdalah. And when it comes to Havdalah, you say the bracha on the wine first. And the Gemara said, this is a major contradiction. By Kiddush, they're very convinced that you have to do the Mekadesh HaShabbos first. And only afterwards, say the bracha on the wine. Havdalah, all of a sudden, it's the exact opposite. What about, why are we changing our rule? If we sanctify the first, do the main bracha first, and then the wine. So that should be with Havdalah, should be the same thing. So that's what the Gemara is bothered with. But in order to get an answer to this question, the Gemara has to first build up the question. What does that mean? The Gemara has to prove that we have a contradiction in Beis Shammai on Beis Shammai. Because what we're going to do is bring a statement. We don't really know who the author is. And we're asking a question on Beis Shammai. How could Beis Shammai say this? Beis Shammai says something else. But we don't know really that statement is from Beis Shammai. Maybe the statement is not a Beis Shammai statement. So maybe Beis Shammai holds that Havdalah, you really do the Havdalah first and then you do the wine. Are we sure that the statement that talks about wine by Havdalah first and then the Havdalah blessing, are we sure that that's a Beis Shammai statement? Maybe Rebbe? That's a statement of Beis Hillel. Maybe that's someone else. Yes.
By Havdalah, I mean, by Kiddush, you have a D'oraisa to be Mekadesh HaShabbos. Where do you have anything like that with Havdalah?
So, B'chnisasa u'b'yitziyasa, it says, Kadshehu, you honor it when it comes in and when it comes out. So it would seem that the bracha of Havdalah is also part of sanctifying the making Shabbos special, escorting Shabbos. So it would seem that that's the reason why the Gemara is bothered with this. And it would logically, maybe Beis Shammai should hold that Havdalah should go first. So what comes out over here is that we're gonna be asking a question on Beis Shammai, but we're asking it from an anonymous statement that we are gonna be labeling Beis Shammai statements. So we have to first be sure that our label is correct, that we are tagging it as a Beis Shammai opinion. And then we're gonna be able to say, oh, now we have a contradiction. So let's look in the Gemara. The Gemara is on the second line, page 52a, the second line. V'savri Beis Shammai d'berchas hayoy madifa. Does Beis Shammai really say that the blessing of the day is the priority, is takes preference? V'hatanya, didn't we learn in a braisa, this is also a tesefta, hanichnas lebeisoy b'maitzei Shabbos, if a person enters his house on Saturday night, mevarech al hayayin, he recites the bracha on the wine, v'al hamor, and on the candle, on the fire, v'al habesamim, and on the spices, v'achar kach omer havdalah, and afterwards you recite the bracha havdalah. So you first say the wine and then the havdalah. That's the main point. We're not really dealing with the other blessings now. The main thing that we're dealing with is the blessing on the wine versus the blessing on the Havdalah, and which one goes, what's the order. And we see that you say the bracha on the wine first and then the Havdalah. Now, the Braisa continues with a statement that we don't really need at this point, but we'll need it later. If a person only has one cup of wine and he wants to eat a meal, so what do you do if you have one cup of wine? You want to eat a meal and, you know, seemingly you should bench with a cup of wine, but you also need that cup of wine for Havdalah, and you're not going to have another cup of wine afterwards, so you're going to be really stuck. So, manichay li'achar hamazon, you put it, you leave it till after you finish eating, and Umashalshalan kulan la'acharav, and you draw all of the blessings of Havdalah, you hang them all three of them, means a chain. You chain them on to afterwards, all of these brachas to the Berachas Hamazon. So what comes out is that from the first statement here, again, the second statement is not so applicable yet, but the first statement is, how do you make Havdalah? You recite Havdalah by wine, and only afterwards the blessing of the Havdalah, Hamavdil bin Kodesh L'Chol. So that's the way you say the bracha on the Havdalah. Now that seems to contradict Beis Shammai would seemingly should hold Havdalah first and then wine, just like he says Kiddush first and then wine, the Mekadesh Shabbos first and then the wine. So why does he do anything different when it comes to Havdalah? So the Gemara says, now if you look at this Tosefta, it says Vohatanya, learned in a Braisa in this Tosefta. If you look at it, does it say Beis Shammai? It doesn't label it as Beis Shammai. It doesn't have any name. It's anonymous. So it's not the strongest contradiction yet, because you could say, well, maybe it's someone else. I don't know if that's Beis Shammai. Beis Shammai holds you, for Kiddush, you'd say the Kiddush first and then the wine, bracha afterwards. Havdalah, probably the same thing. And this Brisa, probably Beis Hillel. I don't know. Some other opinion. It doesn't say Beis Shammai. So the Gemara asks, Vahami, mai de Beis Shammai? In this Brisa, who says it's Beis Shammai? Don't know Beis Hillel. Maybe it's Beis Hillel. So the Gemara says, Leisalka Daitoch. We don't let that go up in our mind. We can't think that it's Beis Hillel. Diktani, because it says in the Brisa, Ma'ar V'yachakach B'samim. Because if you look at the order, you know, now we got to do our research. Now we're putting on our research caps, and we're seeing, is this possible to be a opinion of Beis Shammai or Beis Hillel? Now, Beis Shammai, we know, says, what bracha do you make first? So Beis Shammai says, you first recite the bracha on the fire, and afterwards you recite the bracha on the spices, which is different than we do. We do the spices and then the fire. But Beis Shammai holds that you first do the fire and then the spices. So the Gemara says that this can't be Beis Hillel, because it says you do the fire first, then the spices. Aman Shammai lay dislay high svara. And who is it that you know of that holds of this? Beis Shammai. That's Beis Shammai who says you do this. So if it talks about the spices and the fire in the order of Beis Shammai, it must be an opinion that we have to label the entire statement Beis Shammai. That must be this view. And that comes out that it's a contradiction to our Mishnah that talks about Kiddush and it has a different order. The Tanya, because we learned in a Braisa, Amar Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Yehuda says, and what does he say? Lo nechlaku Beis Shammai Beis Hillel al hamazon sheyesh betchila. I'm sorry. Lo nechlaku Beis Shammai Beis Hillel al hamazon she betchila v'al havdala she b'sayf. Beis Shammai Beis Hillel don't argue on what you do first and what you do last. For sure, you do the grace after meal first and the havdalah last. That there's no question about that. The only question would be, what do you do in the middle? Alma nechloku, what do they argue about? Al hamar v'alavasam. They argue about the fire and the spices. Beis Shammai says hamar. Beis Shammai says ma'ar v'yachakach b'samim. First you do ma'ar, the fire, and then you do b'samim. Beis Hillel says b'samim v'yachakach ma'ar. That you first do spices and afterwards you do the fire. So we see that this statement of the Braisa must be Beis Shammai, because it talks about first doing the fire and then doing the spices. Because we have an argument somewhere else where Rabbi Yehuda says that Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel argue what the correct order is. And And if this brisa says the order of Beis Shammai, that means that this statement must be a Beis Shammai statement. So the Gemara says, you got it all wrong. Rabbi Yehuda has his way of understanding the argument of Beis Shammai Beis Hillel. But there's also a Reb Meir that has another way of explaining the argument of Beis Shammai Beis Hillel differently. And according to Reb Meir, both of them agree that the fire comes before the spices. So this statement of the Brisa that we don't have a name for, maybe it's not Beis Shammai. Because Reb Meir explains the argument of Beis Shammai Beis Hillel a little differently. And according to the way he explains it, Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel both hold that the fire comes before the spices. So the statement of the Brisa might be a Beis Hillel statement, not a Beis Shammai statement. So the Gemara says, how do you know it's a Beis Shammai statement and you're explaining the argument according to Rabbi Yehuda? Then when Beis Hillel, maybe it's following, maybe it's really a Beis Hillel statement. And Va'aliba de Reb Meir, and it's following Reb Meir's way of explaining the argument. So the Gemara says, no, you can't say it that way. Because our Mishnah, who is Reb Meir's explanation of the argument, what does our Mishnah say? And this is very important to remember our Mishnah. What did our Mishnah say? So it's brought here. Beis Shammai Omer, Beis Shammai says, Neru mazin b'samim b'havdalah, that you do fire, you do the grace after meal, you do the spices, and then you do Havdalah. Beis Hillel says you do ner, besamim, fire, and then spices, and then the grace after meal, and then Havdalah. So what is the real argument, according to Reb Meir? It's not about if fire comes before spices or spices comes before fire. That everyone agrees. The fire comes before the spices. But the argument is, when do you do the grace after meal? Is the grace after meal done first? According to this explanation, I shouldn't say, is the grace after meal done first? Is the grace after meal done second or third? That's the question. Is grace after meal second? In other words, first you do fire and then grace after meal? Or is it third? First you do fire and spices and then you do grace after meal. So that's what their argument is. And v'hasam b'braisa katani emein lai ala kais echad ma'nichai la'achar ha'mazayn mashal shalom kulon li'achar. And the braisa that we're trying to give a name for, we're trying to figure out who the author is. This braisa, it says that if he only has one cup, what do? You do the grace after meal first, not second or third. It's first. So the way of Reb Meir is explaining it doesn't fit at all with this braisa. We have to only follow Reb Yehuda's way of explaining the argument. And in Reb Yehuda's way of explaining the argument, this braisa follows Beis Shammai. And according to that, we have a question, a contradiction between Beis Shammai here and the Beis Shammai regarding Kiddush. And that is the question that we are going to conclude with. I do have a sheet that I was going to do my first share screen. I really put together a sheet. I actually have a sheet on this to make it more easy, but now we've done it inside. Tomorrow, Mr. Shem will do, I'll pull up the share screen and we'll have a sheet that has like different opinions to make it a little more clear. But otherwise we are going to stop here. Zai Gesund, have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi.
Are you going to send it?